if you had already bought some candy, don't have a place to drop it off. 817 Foster Street. Just come on anytime. And you know, I like Reese's Peanut Butter Cups. I know y'all probably bought the store out, but you just can't, you know, they'll melt. So just bring them by my house. I'll make sure that they are safely dealt with and discarded. Nothing left. No. Let me just remind you of what we mentioned this morning. Ladies' Conference, that is next Saturday at Eastside Baptist Church in Memphis, and hope that you'll participate in that. Also remember that next Sunday is our churchwide Thanksgiving meal. This is our gift to you. Don't worry about bringing anything except a healthy appetite, and we'll have a great time together. By the way, the boys and girls are going to be bringing in our boxes next Sunday. I need to meet with all of them at 9:50. So if you could let them out of Sunday school a minute or two early, 9:50, and we'll get somewhat organized. I know it's kind of like herding cats, but we will get somewhat organized out there. Also, we've had a real good response to our churchwide shopping trip. That is Thursday, December 3rd. Also, our spring trip is coming up. You wouldn't believe it, but we're already talking about a fall trip for next fall. They are kind of hounding us, offering us all sorts of discounts. So you stay tuned. We'll probably have an announcement at least by the end of the year. Okay, what prayer concerns do we have tonight? No, we have several people who died. Tyler, who is Lynette's brother, Tyler Barkin.
Barbara.
I've called him Barkin all along. Barbara. Who else?
I have a friend who died, Manley Hardin.
Yeah.
His funeral is Tuesday, so he was my right-hand man at Operation Christmas Child for years.
Oh,
and right. He's a great guy. I mean, he's been sick for a long time, but
this is all right.
Pray for Betty and the family.
Absolutely.
And of course, the Ricky Wiley family. Yeah. My friend Ricky died. We had his funeral on Friday, so.
Waiting on a kidney, wasn't that what it was?
Yeah.
White Marsh?
I'm sorry.
White Marsh, you're saying.
Yeah, when is his service? Do we have any information about that?
Today.
Oh, it was this afternoon. Oh, well, of course, I didn't know them, and I think they're longtime members of Poppy Corner. As were Tyler and his family, long-term members. What about praises? God answered anybody's prayer this week? I know God is at work. You know, I'm grateful no more political ads.
Amen.
The election might go on for another 6 months, but at least no political ads. Those make me so nervous. And no more signs and all of that. So any praises?
Well, if you're ever driven in Jackson, you know, there's a bunch of crazy people driving over there, so I thank God he kept me safe this week. I'm almost a bunch of times.
Well, hey, God has spared Brother John's life for a reason. Don't you believe that?
Amen.
I know one of the reasons. I don't know all of them, but I know one of the reasons so he can lead worship for us, and he does a great job.
Amen.
All right, let's pray together. Heavenly Father, we thank you so much for the privilege of being here tonight. We just had a great service this morning, and I pray that you would do it again. Lord, help us not to just to kind of relax and sit back tonight, put it on autopilot. We're expecting you to move and work in our midst. Lord, every time we gather, there is the potential for revival to break out. And I pray that it would break out even tonight, even among us. Lord, you have used groups much, much smaller than this to bring the glory to yourself. And I do pray that you would send a revival, that it would begin in me. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen, John.
I meant to tell you this morning, You're talking about spiritual gifts. Everybody has a spiritual gift. Well, I have a good friend who is, he's very intelligent, but he's also off a little bit. I tell him that too.
Yeah, most smart people.
He'll tell you his spiritual gift is discouragement.
Discouragement.
So,
well, if you like that.
Anyway. All right, let's stand and sing number Way of the Cross Leads Home, 151, if you want to use the hymn.
The way of the cross.
You know, this is the Thanksgiving season, and when I think of all my blessings, and I'm thankful for a whole bunch of stuff, one of the greatest things I'm thankful for is that I'm redeemed by the blood of the Lamb.
Amen.
I pray that all of us that are here tonight can see this. I've had this song on my heart this week, so I said I'm going to sing it. So this is called I Stand Redeemed. When I think of all my faults and all my failures, when I consider all the times I've let God down, I am humbled by the grace He has extended. I'm amazed at the mercy I have found. I could never earn love on my own, yet every time I come before His throne, I stand redeemed by the blood of the Lamb. I stand redeemed before the great I Am. When He looks at me, He sees the nail-scarred hand that bought my liberty. I stand redeemed. Even at my best, I am unworthy. I have nothing precious I can give. Broken life is all I have to offer, and yet it is a priceless gift to Him. The bitter mark of sin will never fade away. I can come before Him
for the last 4 or 5 weeks. We've been looking at Ephesians chapter 6, and your Bible probably just falls open to it automatically. When I was a child, our pastor was a great, great preacher. I just loved his preaching so much, but he preached through the book of Jonah, 4 chapters for 6 months. Wow. 6 months in Jonah. That was great. I still have some of my notes, but how in the world he squeezed 6 months out of 4 chapters, I will never know. I've gotten 4 sermons out of chapter 6 here. Ephesians 6, let me just pick up in verse 17, read down verse 20 or so. And take the helmet of salvation and the sword of the Spirit, which is the Word of God. Pray always with all power and supplication in the Spirit, being watchful to this end, with all perseverance and supplication for all the saints. And for me, that utterance may be given to me. Paul says, you pray that my tongue would be loosened and that I would be an effective preacher. Yeah, you ought to pray the same thing for me as well. That I may open my mouth boldly to make known the mystery of the gospel, for which I'm an ambassador in chains, that in it I may speak boldly as I ought to speak. This is one of the books Paul writes from prison. So he says, you pray that I'll be given the ability and the freedom to preach, and that my chains would be a means of blessing rather than a means of burden. But we especially tonight want to look at verse 18. Let's start the sermon with a word of prayer. Lord, loosen my tongue tonight. What Paul asked desperately that people would do for him, I'm asking desperately that you would do that for me as well. Loosen my tongue. I pray that the words that I speak would be clear, that they would find receptive hearts. We trust your word that it will not return void. Just like these Operation Christmas Child boxes, they contain little word of scripture. And Lord, only you know the millions of boys and girls and their families who've come to know you, all because of the power of your word. And I pray that it would be powerful tonight. It would be a two-edged sword dividing truth from error. In Jesus' name, amen. Last several weeks, we've been talking about spiritual warfare. We started, and I think it's essential that we started by knowing our enemy. You've got to know what you're up against. You have an enemy who absolutely hates you. Jesus said the thief comes to steal, kill, and destroy. But I've come that you might have life and life more abundantly. Jesus told Peter in the upper room, Satan desires to sift you like wheat. Sifting means separation. You're saying, well, does that mean we lose our salvation? No. Once a person is born, he can't be unborn, can he? Mm-hmm. You know, you can move to China and change your name, but your identity is still the same, no matter what you call yourself or no matter the type of life you live. What he's talking about is the separation of your Christian joy from your Christian experience. I know a lot of believers who don't have any joy at all. I mean, they've got their fire insurance. The blood of Jesus covers them. Their room is reserved there in heaven. But there's no joy whatsoever. Now, sometimes that ought to lead us to question whether or not they genuinely had a born-again experience. When Jesus Christ enters a life, he always leaves a footprint, doesn't he? If your sins have been forgiven, you've been adopted in the family of God, you ought to show it in the way you look and act and react to people. So we talked about our enemy. You know that there are people at the Bureau of Engraving, all they do all day long is stare at a dollar bill. Wouldn't that be a boring job, just looking at currency all day long, knowing that you'll never be able to have it? You know, I just roll up a couple of $100 sheets and nobody will know it. But they stare all day long at currency, and the reason they do that is because when counterfeit bills come up, they recognize them immediately. You know, the watermark, the seal, the wording, whatever. Because they know the real thing, they can spot a phony a mile away. And the same thing is true with your relationship with Christ. The more you get to know him, the more you can ascertain what's phony and what's fake. And that's one of the ways by which we unveil Satan and unmask him. We know the truth, and we know when we're being played or lied to. And then we talked about our defensive equipment, our armor. We don't stand there totally vulnerable to the attacks of the enemy. We have some means of protection. And you know what we talked about, the helmet of salvation, the breastplate of righteousness, shoes shod with the gospel of peace. You remember that. It's earlier in the chapter. And then last week we talked about knowing your weapon. You have one offensive weapon. That is the Word of God. It is described as a double-edged sword. In those days, the most dangerous weapon was about a four-foot-long sword that was sharpened to a razor-fine point. And with that, you could lop somebody's head off, literally. That is what the Word of God is. It is a two-edged sword. I could tell story after story about armies and political parties and all of that who were felled by the sword of the Spirit, the Word of God. And that will be the only way that we will survive as a nation, is a dedication to prayer and the Word of God. You know, both of them are like wings of an eagle or wings of a plane. But let me just tell you, this is my opinion. Of the two, I'm almost convinced that prayer is the more important. Prayer has been around since the Garden of Eden. Now, reading the Word of God has only been around for about 500 years. The Roman Catholic Church did not want people to read the Bible. They knew if people read the Bible, they'd discover the truth, and they would reject all that they'd ever been taught. Martin Luther got a hold of a copy of Romans, and he was so incensed by what they practiced as compared to what they should have been doing that he went and nailed 95 complaints on a castle door in Wittenberg, Germany, October 31st, 1517. So they didn't want anybody to read. And by the way, only the priests could read anyway. Even most kings and queens were illiterate. So I think prayer is perhaps the more important of the two. And that brings me to what we're talking about tonight. Know your assignment. What are you supposed to do as you engage in spiritual warfare? I wish I had turned around better. I don't know that I saw all of our men and women who served in uniform. I tried to inquire of you as you left, but I know several of you men served in the Navy. How many Navy men do we have? Let's see your hands. Oh, got a house full here. Well, I talked to some Navy guys this morning. You know, I really like watching movies about the Navy. I don't know why. But one of my favorite movies is The Caine Mutiny. Do y'all know that movie with Humphrey Bogart? It's clean. It's a good family movie. Fred McMurray, Before My Three Sons, by the way. It is a great movie. And, you know, it's all about a ship and a captain who sort of snapped and they had to take over. But several times in the movie, they would cry out, "Battle stations!" And everybody knew exactly where he was supposed to be. Your battle station might have been 10 feet from the fan table, or it might have been 4 feet from the bow. Everybody had a position. And if the enemy was approaching or they saw a torpedo or whatever, they would cry out, "Battle stations!" And everyone would assume his position of responsibility. Let's imagine tonight that God is calling out, "Battle stations, where do you go? What is your assignment?" Well, let me tell you, your assignment is prayer. That is the only way you will defeat Satan, is through prayer. I love the story in Exodus 17. The Israelites were fighting the Amalekites. And Moses held up that rod, which was a symbol of God's power. With that rod, the Red Sea was parted. With that rod, he made the mistake of hitting the rock and the water came forward, and that's what prevented him from being able to enter the promised land, because he hit it instead of just speaking to it like God had asked him to do. But he held up his rod. As long as the rod in his hand was up in the air, the Israelites were winning. But you know, you can't do that for long distance periods of time. You know, kind of like a puppet show. If you've ever done a puppet show, after about 3 minutes or so, your arm gets heavy. So he had a couple of guys, Joshua and Hur, and they held his arms up, and that way he could pray and inspire his troops. Did you know that Jews, when they prayed in the Bible, they prayed just like this. They extended their arms to heaven. Not saying that kneeling is not important. It's a very important component of prayer. But kneeling really was sort of late in Jewish history. Generally, this is how they prayed. So Moses prayed all day, all night, and the battle waxed and waned. But as long as his arms were up, they found power in prayer. And I like how the King James translates it. It says they disconfided the enemy. I hope I'm pronouncing that right. They disconfided the enemy. You know what that literally means? It means they beat the stuffing out of them. As long as prayer was being offered, I mean these Hebrew troops were absolutely victorious. Every one of us know believers who are defeated and miserable and joyless. They just live these lives that, you know, every day is a burden, every day is a battle. You know, they don't think about their blessings. They just think about all of the problems that they have. And one possible reason is that they don't pray. You know, the Bible says that we ought to pray without ceasing. And that phrase refers to a persistent cough. Either you're coughing or you're on the verge of a cough all the time. That ought to be your position as a believer. You're either praying or on the verge of a prayer all the time. So they may not be praying, or they may be tainted with sin, and that's causing static between them and God. You know, the Bible says, if I retain sin in my heart, the Lord will not hear me. If there's unconfessed sin in your life, and you've just gone so long that it's become comfortable to you, it's become second nature to you, that will have an effect on your prayer life. Isaiah 1:15 says, when you spread out, there's that expression, when you spread out your hands in prayer, I will hide my eyes from you. Even if you offer many prayers, I will not listen because your hands are full of blood. So because of sin, God absolutely refused to listen to their prayers. Paul says, as we engage in spiritual warfare, our assignment is to pray in the Spirit. Spirit-led, Spirit-filled, Spirit-guided prayer. What does it mean to pray in the Spirit? Let me just take this entire passage and try to summarize it in one sentence. Your spiritual victories come in direct proportion to the quality of your prayer time. Your spiritual victories come in direct proportion to the quality of your prayer time. So let's talk about what it means to pray in the Spirit. Number one, praying in the Spirit is prayer that listens. In other words, you listen to the voice of the Spirit of God. Prayer is a dialogue. It's not a monologue. You listen as well as converse with Almighty God, but primarily you listen to the voice of the Spirit of God. You depend upon Him. You're guided by Him. Paul writes in Romans 8, the Holy Spirit helps us in our weakness. For we don't know how to pray, but the Spirit prays for us with groans that cannot be uttered. You ever prayed and had such a deep burden that you couldn't even vocalize it or verbalize it? I've been there. I'm sure you have as well. I mean, September 11th. All I could do was just cry out to God. If you were listening to my prayer, it probably didn't make any sense to you at all. But I know the Spirit of God took those words and magnified them 1,000 times over. He's there praying for us and interceding on our behalf. Who is the Holy Spirit? There are certain churches and denominations that they've gone to seed on the Holy Spirit. They believe you've got to speak in tongues, and they have some unique worship experiences. And I'm not being critical at all. You know, they serve the same God. They say Jesus is Lord. They may, you know, interpret a little bit differently than we do. Hey, they're my brother and sisters in Christ. But I think sometimes people sort of go to seed on the Spirit. On the other hand, I think there are people who kind of diminish the Spirit's role in their lives and in the church. And what modern preaching needs to do is to bring the Spirit of God back into the fellowship. Let Him have His assigned place. Let Him do the work that He wants to do in the midst of God's people. The Spirit of God is God's ongoing presence in the world. Before Jesus left, He said, "You'll receive power after the Spirit of God comes upon you, and you'll be witnesses unto me in Jerusalem, Judea, Samaria, and the uttermost part of the earth." Then in Acts chapter 2, they were all together, they were all filled with the Spirit of God, and they left there, they fanned out, and carried the gospel to the entire known world. What does the Spirit of God do? When you pray in the Spirit and you listen to the Spirit, you need to remember John 14, 26. The Spirit of God teaches us all things. You can't understand anything without the presence and the guidance of the Spirit of God. John 16, 8 says that He convicts of sin. I don't want you to be convicted by anything I say. I want you to be convicted by the Spirit of God working in your heart. Now, don't say that's the same thing as conscience. It's not. Everybody has a conscience. You know, that little inner feeling that can be ignored or seared if we want it to be. But just because your conscience is bothering you, you make sure that it's your conscience and not the Spirit of God at work. You know, the Bible says, test the spirits. Make sure they've come from God. John 14, 16 says that He is our comforter when we're sad. Ephesians 1, 13, He seals us. That's an agricultural term that talks about what you do to your cattle. You put a brand on them. We've been branded by the Spirit of God as a demonstration to Satan. Hey, we are off limits. Don't you poach, because we are in God's pasture. And we are as numerous as the cattle on 1,000 hills. Romans 8, 16, it says the Spirit of God assures us that we're the children of God. Sometimes we kind of wonder, but you've got the assurance of the Spirit that you are indeed a child of God. Galatians 5, He produces fruit, the fruit of the Spirit. Love, joy, peace, patience, gentleness, goodness, faith, meekness, and self-control. All of that is evidence that the Spirit of God is at work in your life. Luke chapter 12 says the Spirit of God gives us the words when we are witnessing. You know, we're called to make disciples. The word disciple is a word that means apprentice. We don't do it anymore, but, you know, say 50 years ago, you wanted to learn how to be a plumber, or be a carpenter, or be a mechanic. You would go and attach yourself to a master. And you would watch that master. That master would teach you, generally for about 3 years or so. They even did that with law. You went and read law, and after 3 years, you didn't have to pass the bar exam. You didn't have to have a law degree. You know, you just became a lawyer after you'd read law for 3 years. And the same thing is true with the disciples of Jesus. They followed Him and listened to Him for 3 years, and then He turned them loose. Well, as a disciple, you ought to have a listening and discerning ear to when the Spirit speaks your name. So praying in the Spirit is prayer that listens. Number two, praying in the Spirit is prayer that lingers. Lingers. He says in verse 18, praying always with prayer and supplication. At all times, your translation may read. All of the time, you ought to be in an attitude, a spirit of prayer. John 15, 7. If you abide in me and my words remain in you, ask whatever you wish and it will be given to you. If you are patient, if you wait on God, if you just maintain this attitude of discipline and listening to the Spirit's voice, eventually God is going to respond. He may say yes, he may say no, he may say not yet. You know, I'm thankful for the times God has said yes, aren't you? I'm thankful for the times God has said no. You know, everybody who's ever been to a high school reunion can be thankful that God said no. I'm grateful that God said not yet sometimes. You know, our problem is we live in an instant society. 150 years ago, when the Pony Express came through once a week, if you missed the Pony Express, well, that's okay. He'll be by next week. Didn't bother you at all. Now, I've got to confess, I get kind of perturbed when I miss one section of a revolving door. I don't like doing that. We are an instant society. You remember when you were growing up, Saturday morning, 11 o'clock, you know, your favorite show, Studio Wrestling, was coming home, and about 10:50, you would go in and start warming up the TV. And it would take, 5 to 10 minutes to get all warmed up and, you know, had all of the switches and tubes and all of that in the back. And my dad would work on it, and I'd stand there with a mirror in front of it. Y'all remember doing that? But it would take 5 or 10 minutes for your television to warm up. And, you know, you had a choice of 3, 5, or 13. That was it. Nowadays, in less than 30 seconds, you can scroll through 150 channels. Who would have thought that? Who would have thought 50 years ago you could put a couple of strips of bacon in a microwave, punch a button, and within 2 minutes it is ready to go? I mean, who'd have thought before the Instant Pot came along, who'd have thought you could stick a frozen roast in an Instant Pot and an hour later it's ready to go? We live in a society that wants things yesterday. We just don't want to wait. We're not willing to wait. I think we think of prayer like the drive-through at Chick-fil-A. I almost said McDonald's, but I've had some unfortunate experiences at McDonald's lately. The drive-through at Chick-fil-A, you know, there are a couple of different windows. You drive up, you say, I want the number 5 supersized. You know, a meal, a sandwich, large fries, large drink. And 15 seconds later, you're at the next window, and you're getting what you ordered. It's amazing how quickly they can fill that order. And a lot of people think of prayer like that. Well, you know, God, I prayed yesterday. Why haven't you responded? You know, why are you so cruel? Why have you turned a deaf ear to me? Praying in the Spirit is prayer that lingers. You know, you just keep doing it for a while. Jesus spent long stretches in prayer. He spent 40 days in the wilderness in prayer and fasting and just preparing for the ministry to which God had called him and the ministry for which God had sent him to the earth. One of my great heroes is John Wesley. He and his brother were the founders of the Methodist religion. And you know, Methodists used to be the largest Protestant religion in the world. Everybody was a Methodist except, you know, those who've been messed with. It was a huge dynamic force. Now it has become largely liberal and sort of irrelevant. But John Wesley is a great hero of mine. He averaged preaching 8 sermons a day his entire life. He would get up at 4 a.m. On his 88th birthday, he wrote in his diary, I am so embarrassed. I hate to admit that I have fallen into the lazy habit of sleeping until 5 a.m. I hope nobody ever finds out. He died of an asthma attack as he was preaching his 13th sermon of the day, age 88. He got asthma and died while preaching. John Wesley prayed
2 hours every single morning. One day, he had a really hectic day ahead of him. He had, I don't know, a dozen or more preaching engagements. He told his wife, "Tomorrow is such a busy day, I don't think I'm going to do my 2 hours of prayer. In fact, it's such a busy day, I think I'm going to do 4 hours in prayer. I'm going to get up at 2 a.m. rather than 4 a.m. Now, that is prayer that lingers. That's what I'm talking about. Number three, praying in the Spirit is prayer that looks. Notice Paul says, be watchful to this end. Always alert. Because we know our adversary, he's sneaky. The Bible talks about the wiles of the devil. You know, he uses things that are unconventional. Now, he's been using the same old playbook for, you know, 4,000 years. We know what he's going to do. We just don't know when and where he's going to appear. We know how he's going to tempt us because he's wily and sneaky. You know, why is prayer that looks and is watchful and is alert, why is that such a threat to Satan? Satan fears a praying believer more than anything else on the face of the earth. And he will find anything in the world to distract us. You know, we'll start getting sleepy, our mind will wander, the phone will ring. You know, all of these interferences, the dog will come in and need attention. You know, I try to spend part of my day in prayer early in the morning, and then when I first get to the office, I try to spend time in prayer, and I should. I mean, hold me accountable if you sense that I'm not doing that, because that's one of the things I've been called to do, is pray for you. But it seems every time I pray, I don't care if it's 2 o'clock in the morning, the phone rings, or I'll get a text. And you know, I don't mind that one bit. You call me 24/7, but it is invariable that somebody will call, or you know, somebody will stop by needing some attention, or I'll have you know, several emails to return, or I will somehow convince myself that I'm not ready for Sunday, and I ought to spend a little more time reading and praying. I, you know, might stop and check a couple of internet sites. I hate to confess that every day I look at ESPN.com and I look at the DrudgeReport.com. I got about 4 that I look at every single day. And you know, sometimes prayer sort of gets shoved aside because I'm just not looking for my adversary, the devil. You know, I love the story of Gideon. These Midianites were surrounding the Hebrew camp, 185,000 of them, and they would swoop down. Did that for 7 years. Finally, God appears to Gideon and says, I'm going to raise up a liberator. And I'm sure Gideon is saying, yes, it's about time. Then God said, oh, by the way, you're going to be that liberator. He wasn't quite as enthusiastic about that. Well, 32,000 gathered. Gideon said, now, if you're afraid, you can go on home, 10,000 left. That's got to be kind of disappointing. You call an army and a third of them leave immediately. Then they go down to the brook to get some water. 9,700 of them get out on their bellies and lap it up like dogs. 300 of them stay on their knees and they cup it and drink it that way. And those are the ones God says, now that's your guys, that is your army. Those are the men you need. And it took me a long time to kind of figure out why it was that drinking water was so important. These 300, they were alert. As they were drinking, they were scanning the horizon. They didn't take off their equipment. They didn't let their guard down. They were alert the whole time, and God used them for a marvelous victory. You know, in the Garden of Gethsemane, Jesus took Peter, James, and John. He went up to a place by himself and prayed and struggled with the will of God. You remember what he told Peter, James, and John? He said, you watch and pray. Jesus knew that 600 men were on their way. They were, you know, trying to work up a mob to come out and arrest him. He said to them, you watch and pray. I went back twice and woke them up. The third time, he just let them sleep on. You know, that was their last opportunity to minister to Jesus and encourage Jesus, and they would rather sleep. They let their guard down when they should have been praying. You know, an angel attended to Jesus, and thank God he did, but you know, I think the reason the angel came and attended to him is that Peter, James, and John fell down on their job. They weren't doing what Jesus had commanded them to do. So be alert when you pray. I went to a political rally one time. I will never forget this. I won't even tell you what party or who the candidate was, but the candidate led us in prayer. He was a good man. He led us in prayer, and he had this real nice leather jacket. And while he was praying, somebody got that jacket. It looked to me like he was trying to steal it. Now, I don't know, but the prayer sort of went like this. Dear God, we thank you. Hey, leave my coat alone. I will never forget that as long as I live. Hey, that's watchful prayer. I mean, that's a guy who was praying and watching at the same time, and good for him. So praying in the Spirit is prayer that listens. It's prayer that lingers. It's prayer that looks. Finally, praying in the Spirit is prayer that labors. He says in verse 18, you've got to persevere in prayer. It is not easy. Perseverance involves fighting. It involves struggling. You know, we love to talk about the eternal security of the believer. You know, once saved, always saved. We love to talk about that. And thank God. You know, if you've truly been born again, you've been adopted in the family of God, you've got a home reserved for you in heaven. But you know, there's a flip side of that. Eternal security of the believer, and the flip side of that is the perseverance of the saints. Which means if you've genuinely been saved, you're going to hold out for Jesus. You're going to stand strong for Him until your dying day. You're not going to let up or slow up. You're going to keep on working no matter where you are, no matter what kind of physical condition you're in. As long as you've got breath, you're going to hold out for Jesus Christ. And it's not going to be easy. You know, I think about the old song, I beg your pardon, I never promised you a rose garden. That is true with prayer. It's a struggle. We've got to labor. Remember, Jesus in the garden sweat drops of blood. I am told by medical professionals that is possible. They said it is incredibly, incredibly rare. They just have a few documented cases every year, but it is absolutely possible. They also say that clear liquid and blood can flow out at the same time. It's liquid around the pericardial sac in the heart. So, you know, the Bible every day is being credited and you know, given credence. We're seeing all of the things of the Bible are really true in spite of all of the doubters out there. James 5:16 says the prayers of a righteous man are powerful and effective. Word righteous there means persevering. Somebody who just perseveres and hangs in there in prayer. I will never forget a night at Southland Baptist Church in Memphis, Tennessee. Yeah, I went there from a child, and the church finally disbanded while I was in college, and I still miss it. You know, I just had so many wonderful experiences there. But we had a lady there who had prayed for her husband's salvation 40 years. Back in the 1930s, she got one of those commitment cards. And she filled it out in pencil, put her husband's name, put the address and everything. The only thing she left blank was the little box that says, Trust Christ as Savior. She put that in her Bible as a reminder to pray for him every single day. And I will never forget the night that J.D. Bumpus walked the aisle and trusted. Y'all got some Bumpus relatives?
Her grandfather and grandmother.
Really? Well, they're some of the sweetest people on the face of the earth. I love them. But I'll never forget when J.D. Bumpus walked the aisle and trusted Christ as a Savior. I mean, we were hooping and hollering and turning cartwheels. It was one of the greatest experiences of my life. And I tell you what made it even greater. that little lady pulled out this card, and I mean, it was about to fall apart. It looked like it had been run over a dozen times. It was yellowed. The address wasn't even the same. They had moved since then. But she, with trembling hand, took a pencil and checked that box. Trust Christ as Savior. And he became a deacon, was one of our very finest members. I mean, God really used him in a very, very great way. Of all of the parables that Jesus taught, I guess the one that is the most difficult to interpret, and I've studied it, and I don't know that I've got a real good grasp on it, but you remember the parable of the friend at midnight? Fella and his family were sound asleep. In those days, even the animals slept inside. So you've got a husband, a wife, four or five kids, a couple of cows, a donkey or two. And next thing you know, at midnight, these were people who went to bed with the chickens. They'd probably been asleep for 4 hours, and this neighbor comes and knocks on the door. And the fellow says, "Hey, leave me alone. It's midnight. I'm asleep." Guy comes back and keeps knocking 2 or 3 times. Man says, "Man, get lost. I just can't deal with you right now. I can't respond." Well, finally, he went to the door and gave the friend what he wanted. That's back in the days where people borrow. Remember those days? You know, you needed a couple of eggs, you'd go next door. When I was growing up on Randy Cove, man, my mother never bought groceries. She'd just go and borrow from Polly Finley or Pat Gordon or, you know, whoever. It was a borrowing society. That's what the man wanted. He wanted to borrow something. And I've always kind of interpreted that as... you know, you bug God enough, God's finally going to throw his hands up and say, "Okay, if you'll leave me alone, I'll just give you what you want." And, you know, that's not the right interpretation. I knew that was wrong, but that's just the only way I could interpret it. You know what it's about? It's about perseverance in prayer. It's about this neighbor who kept coming back. You know, even though he'd been told no, even though he knew it was kind of a long shot, he kept coming back. And because he kept coming back, he eventually had his request filled. That's what prayer is all about. You know, we don't give up with the first no. You know, you men, when you proposed to your wife, suppose you had said forget it the first time she said no. Some of you may have been told no 10 times. You know, suppose you just said, "Well, okay," and walked away. Aren't you glad you persevered? Adonna asked me 4 times before I finally said yes. And I'm glad that I did. She persevered, and that's what we ought to do. So praying in the Spirit is your battle station. That is your assignment. When the enemy attacks, you go find your place. We are a great warship for the glory of God. We're not the love boat. We're a great warship for the glory of God, and everybody has a battle station. We are under attack. Missiles are being hurled at us. Torpedoes are coming our way. Kamikaze bombers are diving even as we speak. So my challenge to you tonight is man your battle station. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we know we're under satanic attack. Even right now, I sense it, Father. But I pray, Lord, that we would remember that victory is ours. And that if we'll just hold fast, if we'll just persevere, one day we will live to see the defeat of our adversary. That old angel is going to come and take him by the neck and throw him into that fiery pit and throw away the key. And Lord, forever and ever and ever, we will enjoy pure, unbroken fellowship, not only with you, but with those who've gone before. And I pray that you would hasten that day. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.